words of life, words of hope, give us strength, help us cope. In this world, where'er we roam, ancient words will guide us home. Ancient words, ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts, oh, let the ancient words impart.
God revealing himself as a supreme being, and we are human beings. and how our beings participation in the being of God. But I said, God speaks to bridge the gap between his almightiness and our smallness. Then we look at the charge of Paul to Timothy to preach the word, and the implication that that has for the authority of the word of God, the inerrancy of the word of God, and the sufficiency of the word of God. We spoke very briefly about the purpose of preaching. The ultimate purpose is to bring life to people, new life. And when the new life has been imparted through faith in Christ Jesus, preaching goes on to enrich the life, to bless the life, to energize the life, to grow the life, and to mature the Christian life and faith. And after saying that, I focused on the fact that at best, Christian biblical preaching is gospel preaching. And we look at the gospel preaching of Christ Jesus and that of Apostle Peter on the day of Pentecost, doing a little analysis of it. We move on to the specific objectives of preaching. And of course, the discussion question, that if this is the ultimate, most important critical point of preaching, preaching the gospel for salvation, redemption, for spiritual nurture and growth, how do we reconcile that? How do we harmonize that? How do we balance that with preaching to meet existential life needs? The physical and the material aspect of us as human beings, how will our preaching enrich that and still stay true to God? Comments were made here and there for us to be able to encourage one another. Then we ended on the notes of samples of expository preaching from various objectives and occasions and contexts. Today, I promised us to go on to the process of preparation for preaching. How do you prepare to preach? I will start with prayer as the starting point. The starting point when you want to preach is to pray. Prayer is the starting point. Then I will highlight very briefly the work of the Holy Spirit in all of us, so that we are very conscious that we are not alone when we stand before people to declare the word of God. And then how do you choose a Bible text, a Bible passage? Then how do you read the reading work? The exegetical work will be combined with the next point, actually. So I'm going to combine the exegesis and interpretation of the text. Then finally, how do you develop the sample? The title, the introduction, the body, and the conclusion. I'll try to speak within 40 minutes so we can gain about 10 minutes. So that is how the Lord has led me to prepare for this workshop today, the process of preparation for preaching. We are going to start with prayer at the starting point, and it is a good point for us to pray as well. Let us pray. Let us bow down our heads as in the words. The word that God has sent to us, I say, God, make me to be an effective communicator of your revelation. Make me to be an effective communication of your word. Teaching and teaching. Let life be imparted. Let life be renewed. Let life be blessed, prospered, energized. Holy Spirit, help me. That's our prayer, O God. Thank you because you have answered us. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We start with the starting point. Prayer as the starting point, or prayer as the beginning point, as Dr. Emiola would like to do. I'm taking this point from the newly produced the minister's manual. That's the newly produced minister's manual. It has a section on preaching. I want all of those who have copies to know that that material is going to be referred to again and again and again. In the process of preaching the word of God, look at the declaration of Jesus Christ. He says, "For I have not spoken of my own authority, but the Father who sent me has himself given me a commandment, what to say and what to speak. And I know that his commandment is eternal life. What I say therefore I say, as the Father has told me, how great it will be if any of us as a preacher can say the same. How great that we can walk on the podium and walk away and say, what God has said to me, that is what I have said to people. In the language of Dr. Ishola, it is presumptuous, therefore, for any preacher never to seek the face of the Lord for appropriate word for the people. Sermon preparation ought to be prayerful preparation. From the very beginning to the very end, when you are preparing to preach, please pray. And I'm talking about prayer as communion with God. Prayer is essentially, first of all, a communion with God. In the biblical revelation, in the Christian faith, the ministry of the Word of God and prayer ministry always go together. Acts chapter 6, verses 2 and 4. Prayer and the Word of God always go together. Prayer should accompany the entire process. Prayer should advance the entire process. Just at the point that you know you need to preach somewhere, whether you have 1 hour to prepare, or 1 day, or 1 week, or 1 month, or 1 year, you should first of all pray and say, God, give me the word that you want me to give to your people. When you are preparing, thinking of the text, you have to pray. When you are trying to read and do analysis, you have to pray. When someone has been prepared and think is ready to deliver, you have to pray. When you want to come up like this and begin, you have to pray. Oh, if the Lord will help you to pray as you preach along, how great has it going to be? Great words can be uttered from the energy of the flesh. It's not going to prosper the kingdom. It will be a good showmanship because God will not have spoken. I give you a personal testimony. In my own life experience, I think I have preached better when I've been able to pray more. There are days that I prepare so well, my outline is fantastic. I'm sure of how to start, how to even move on, and how to end. And many, many times I go to be disappointed because I have not spoken with an attitude of prayer. And there are days that I'm afraid to want to repeat. I just thought that my prayer is not adequate. Sometimes I'm moved close to tears and I say, God, you see where I find myself. Now I have to preach and I'm not prepared well. But God can use me. And I want to stand before you and tell you that many, many times I have preached better. Because when I stand like this, I have myself know that I am speaking in the Spirit of God. Preacher, please pray. Please pray. As you want to think about praying. That's why for many pastors, the study room is also their prayer room. Yes, you are reading, you are praying, you are meditating. Sometimes you sleep off here, it's better off. You sleep in the process of preparing sermon, you are weak, you are tired. Sometimes you come out of shoes that shock you. Sometimes you shed your tears and you come back to life. It's all part of preparation. 2 Timothy chapter 2 verse 7 says, reflect on this thing and the Lord will give you understanding. Reflect on this thing, think about this thing, meditate on this thing. Reflection, thinking, meditation, they all go together. Through that process, it says that God will give you understanding. Some verses say that God will give you insight, that God will give you revelation. When you think and study and meditate, understanding will come, revelation will come, insight will come. John R. W. Stott, commenting on that verse, says, what the Lord has done together, let no one put asunder. The Lord has joined together insight, revelation, understanding that comes as a result of a man meditating, thinking, and also praying. If you are praying well, you have prepared well to preach. You have not prepared well to preach until you have prayed well. May the Lord make all of us who are speakers of His word to be prayer giants in the name of Jesus. Let's move on. The work of the Holy Spirit. He says, the Holy Spirit empowers preacher and the hearers. As Paul testified about the role of the Holy Spirit in preaching, he asserted, again, quoting from the minister's manual, because Baba should have wrote the article of preaching. He says, I was in weakness and fear and great trembling among you. And my language and my message were not set forth in persuasive words of wisdom, but they were in demonstration of the Holy Spirit and power, so that your faith might not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. A great word of testimony of Apostle Paul. So that your faith might not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Paul was convinced that he spoke in the Spirit among Corinthians. He ministered in the Spirit among Corinthians. Why do we have to depend on the Holy Spirit when you want to prepare to preach? I thought it's very simple. The Holy Spirit is the author of the word that you are about to preach. It's not your word. I was invited to replace when I wrote the Sunday school Bible study in Romans in 1984. And as I thought and thought and thought the book, the pastor said, it is good when an author teaches his book. When an author teaches his book, it makes a big difference. The Holy Spirit is the author of the Word of God. These are not mere human words. They were words that were inspired by the Spirit. They are the very breath of God. So, if you depend on the Holy Spirit, then you'll be able to explain the Word of the Spirit. You must speak with the Spirit. 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 20 and 21 tells us about this. Above all, you must understand that no prophecy of Scripture came about this prophet's own interpretation. For prophecy never had its origin in the will of man. But men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. The Bible is words of the Spirit. Blessed be the preacher who prepares in the Spirit, who speaks in the Spirit, who ministers in the Spirit. Beloved, our world has no power of its own to redeem life, to nurture life, to encourage. But when our world becomes the words of the Spirit, when our words is backed up by the Holy Spirit, they can achieve great wonders and signs and miracles in the life of people. The preacher must be a man of the Spirit, speaking in the Spirit, preparing the Spirit, so that the Holy Spirit can take over his words, and his words can become the very words of God. Next, I'd like to make some comments about the choice of that test. You have prepared, you have recognized the need for you to be in the Spirit. Now you want to choose your test. Some of the general principles for the choice of the Bible test of preaching, they are, number one, the spiritual needs of people. The spiritual needs of the people. You have to consider what are the needs of the people. Why that particular sermon? What is the objective? Yesterday, in workshop one, we went through a number of objectives. What do you want to achieve? What do you believe God is asking you to say to achieve the life of these people? As we did yesterday. Then what is the location of the sermon? The ability of the preacher to present the subject, the sermon truth that is preached, and so on and so forth. Let me make a few comments on each and every one of these. The Lord can save everybody, anybody in any sermon. But the sermon can be preached primarily for evangelistic purpose, to win soul. A sermon can be preached to teach people about improvement in relationship. That is not essentially an evangelistic sermon. And it is a good sermon, it is still a word from the Lord. You should be very clear in your mind what is the specific objective that you would like to achieve. And of course, the occasion of the sermon is very, very important. A good sermon that I have preached at the beginning of the year is this year also. From Luke chapter 13, verses 1 to 5. This year also. And of course, with regard to the ability of the preacher to present the subject. A good preacher of the word of God who has prayed, who is in the spirit, can use an obscure passage to preach a sermon that is going to bless you and energize people. It all depends on how mature we are as preachers of the word of God. How do you choose a text? Sometimes if you are preaching a sample of truth, you are preaching a sermon series, you come to a point where you have to preach on a particular topic, a subject that otherwise you would not have chosen unless you are going through a sermon series. This is the next thing you have to preach about. You have to preach it. I recall that while I was in Mary Massey Church in New York, I was preaching through the Ten Commandments. I was speaking one commandment every Sunday, preaching. And the day came when I was supposed to preach on you shall not kill or you shall not murder. And I learned many interesting things about the history of the church. That one of the worst cases that the church will not be dead, that the church will not have to bury was somebody who committed suicide. In church history, priests were reluctant to bury people who committed suicide. And I made that point as part of the sermon. Ordinarily, I would not have thought about preaching that kind of a topic, but I was dealing with the sample of truth, and now I have to deal with that. 3 months after, there was a time of my testimony, and another young woman, a great grandmother actually, we call her a witch. This woman, once in a while, she would bring me a matchbox, she would bring me one basso, she would bring me one cup of pepper, and all of this. I say, this is the pastor's gift, the prophet of God. And one day she was giving testimony. She said, "He said, Nihinlola, who asked me not to kill myself?" And I was wondering, you know, she was old enough to call me by my first name. She was a great grandmother. She herself had only one child, and that only one child was a grandmother. So she herself called that her child mommy. Yes, she called that child mommy. But suddenly, mommy died. The only child of her life died. And everybody was saying around that this woman was a witch. She had only one elderly child, and that elderly child has also died. And she wanted to kill herself. And she was in that mood when I preached the sermon on you shall not kill, you shall not murder, you shall not kill yourself. And so she came and said, he said, Nihinlola, who taught me not to kill myself, not to commit suicide? How grateful I was to God for that. I want to say that while I was pastor of the church, I preached many sermon series upon series. And I write out my full text, 6, 7, 8 pages. I have about 50 files in my office at home. And every file contains about 10 samples. So I have about 500 written samples. I have preached virtually on every kind of subject anybody could think about. It's only once in a while that I have to do fresh sermon preparation. And usually it takes me about 6 hours to prepare a fresh sermon. Preaching sermon truth can force you to preach on an otherwise topic that you yourself would not like to preach about the text. He says, the text may be assigned, and when it is not, you should be chosen prayerfully and carefully. Many times when you are going to preach, somebody will choose the text for you and say, this is the text. If you read it and you read it and you pray and you are satisfied, you go ahead. But if you have good reasons to change the text, please change the text. If you read and God is not speaking to you through the text, please choose another text prayerfully and tell the people that you have chosen another text because God is not speaking to you through the particular text that they have assigned you. Qualities of the chosen text: relevance to the sermon goal and application. Very, very important. Very, very important. And then brevity. The more concise the text, the easier for the preacher to keep the focus. The text can be a verse when you want to do a word study. It may be a verse, or it may be, just a word like grace. Or it may be a sentence. Many people have preached great sermons on John 3:16. For God so loved the world, the sermon about the love of God. preach someone about salvation. It can be a paragraph. A paragraph is a good choice of a Bible text for preaching. A paragraph is a unit of thoughts. And so God will thank God for Christian scholars that God has used to introduce paragraphs into the Bible. The revelation did not come by paragraph. It is those who came to study the revelation that they have been putting down who have given us the paragraph. And the paragraph is closer to the pericope that we are about. Pericope is a distinct biblical word and terminology. Actually, by definition, the pericope is an extract from the text, especially a passage from the Bible. That's what it is, the pericope. Pericope. The paragraph, a minute of story. But sometimes you don't have the presence of the paragraph, because it may be a whole story, like you try to preach to us from the whole story. Maybe by the whole story of 20 verses, or 25 verses, or 30 verses that you would like to preach upon, you still have to read it anyway, if you have the time. The preacher is the one who does not have the time, so he chooses only a portion of the story. So, you choose the text, it's very important. Sometimes, two, three different stories may give you the same, different versions of the same story. Mark has something about it, Luke, Matthew, also Mark, or John. And you need to read various versions of the synoptic gospels, of the biblical gospels, and decide which of these is best for you. All of that should be done prayerfully. All of that should be done in the Spirit, in the attitude of dependence of the Holy Spirit. Now that we are choosing your text, let's move on now to reading the text. Reading work. Please remove the word exegetical in your thoughts. When I revise it, we remove exegetical at that point. It's a fairly long passage, and we are going to read it together. Again from S. Adipola Shola. Reverend Dr. Adipola Shola has really labored for us to start preaching in the seminary, and I thought that his comment and his ideas should be valued because of his passion that God has given him for us to start. After he ended his tenure at the seminary, and he came back to the seminary and said, how can we have a seminary and not have preaching specialization? What would that mean for his life? So let's read this fairly long passage together on reading one. Are you ready? Okay. Once the preacher has settled for the text or passage, there should be a contemplative reading of the Word of God. This is one challenge point for every preacher when casual reading of the sacred text becomes a routine. The reading of God's Word for the people should first be mulled over by the preacher. Some old homileticians, such as G. Campbell Morgan, have suggested reading the chosen passage for as much as 50 times before any exegetical or analytical work starts. Out of the many times you will have read the text, it will be in different versions, including its mother tongue. When you have chosen a text, please read the text. Read it and read it and read it. Read it when you are weak and tired. Read it when you wake up early in the morning. Read the text using all kinds of occasions. And please try to read the text in a number of versions. Don't depend only on the version that is very familiar with you. If you are getting any puzzle, try to read how it reads in the RSV or NIV. If you are a good news person, that is the version that you are familiar with. Please read that same text using other versions. And read it many times. And this time you read it, please take notes. If you are paper and pencil generation, continue to take notes as you read. This time you read, you get something. If you are a mobile device generation, then open the note, open the file, the computer. This time you read, God will give you one or two ideas, put it down. Please put it down when the thought comes to you. If you don't, you may lose it. And losing one single point like that can be a significant loss in the thoughts. Because if your mind is on the text, even when you are not thinking about it, the Spirit of God will give you something. Please put it down. Don't think that because it has come, you may not lose it. You may lose it. That's the way the Spirit works. So read and read and read and read. Preacher of the Word of God must love the Word of God. We must eat the scroll, Ezekiel chapter 3, verses 1 to 3. Two times Ezekiel was told, he was informed as part of his call and commission and conversion. Eat the scroll, eat the scroll. Preachers, let us eat the scroll. Let us be very, very familiar with the scroll. Let us eat it. Let us drink it. Let us digest it. Let it become part of ourselves to the point that we can analyze it and then we can even live it out. Preaching is effective when it is demonstrated in our life. It is scroll. In our evangelical tradition, we must remember that the gospel minister is essentially a minister of the Word of God. There is no other secret for a successful pastoral work other than the Word of God and prayer. There is no other secret. In some church traditions, they believe that the preacher is a priest, the offer them sacrament. And once they take sacrament, they are okay. We also believe the sacrament is the call of ordinances, baptism, the Holy Communion, the Lord's Supper, all of that. But we believe that the essential tool and power for ministry to redeem souls and to nurture souls is the Word of God. Please love the Word. Please read the Word so you can lead the people of God from the consciousness of the Word of God. The Lord will help us to be faithful to the preaching and teaching of the Word of God in the name of Jesus. If you preach well, you teach well the Word of God, then you have ministered well. But you have not ministered well until you have preached the Word of God and taught the Word of God very well. Let's now move on to the exegetical type work and interpretation of text. Exegesis and interpretation at this point. Very important. Two words are very important at this point. That is exegesis and exegesis. I need to remind you. Of course, exegesis is the more familiar word. E-X-E-G-E-S-I-S. Exegesis. Very simple word. The second one is eisegesis. E-I-S-E-G-E-S-I-S. Do we hear the word exegesis again and again and again? What does it mean? The word exegesis means to bring out the meaning from the text. To draw out, to bring out the meaning in the text. Usually in that interpretation, exegesis is the task of trying to discover what the text meant to the original reader. When Paul was writing Timothy, what did Paul have in mind exactly? We will try to enter into the thought of Paul, into the thought of the first century, into the thought of the Roman culture, to be able to know what Paul, how Paul wanted Timothy to understand the text. That's the task of exegesis.
And the second one is you cannot see it. Right? You want to go there?
Oh, yeah. The other one is exegesis. There's a third one, I told you that I forgot. There's a third one, I tried to. So, to do exegesis is to bring out the meaning, to draw it out from the text. And as I said, the purpose of exegesis is to try to see what that word meant to the original writer and recipient. How was the original recipient meant to understand the world? That's exegesis. When you have done the task of exegesis very well, the result you get in Abuja is the result you get in promotion, is the result you get in London, is the result you are going to get in New York, every part of the world. That's the task of the exegesis. Now, what makes the task of the exegesis very critical is because there is a gap between the text, an ancient text, and you, who is the modern reader, modern interpreter. There's a gap. The gap is partly language gap. Most of us cannot read the Bible in the original language in which it was written, Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek. So we depend on the English language, and then our mother tongue, if we have the Bible. So there is a gap, a language gap. There's many, many times a culture gap, the culture that informed the text. There's a gap that has to do with geography and the climate of the text, and many, many other things. You just must recognize that many, many times there is a gap between you and the text. You should not take that for granted. So the exegesis task helps you, a significant task, helps you to bring out the meaning, to draw out the meaning. How you do that, you are going to talk a little bit about it more. The opposite of exegesis is eisegesis. That is to impose your own meaning on the text. Instead of drawing out the meaning from the text, you impose what you think the text is supposed to mean to achieve. Many people don't do that deliberately. They do it out of ignorance. They do it because they ignore the context, the occasion that informed that biblical revelation. When God speaks, God never speaks in the vacuum. There is always a context to every revelation of God. If you understand the context of that revelation, you will understand that revelation and that message even better. Many, many times, people who do exegesis, they do it because they are eager to apply. They don't take the time to interpret, they don't take the time to do exegesis, they are very much interested in application. The second issue is they are very eager to draw moral lessons from scriptures. Moral lessons from scriptures. It is good to draw moral lessons from scriptures, but some moral lessons must not be out of tune with the context of the biblical revelation. Somebody was counseling former drug addicts, and he wanted them to do without alcohol and drugs and all of that, and use Colossians 2:21 for the passage to counsel these young unbelievers. You know what Colossians 2:21 says? Do not handle, do not taste, do not touch. And that's wrong. Alcohol, cigarette, drugs, don't handle it, don't taste it, and don't touch it. And because the new believers believe it is coming from the word of God, from the Bible, it is God's word. But that was not the context of the message. That is what we call topological interpretation of the Bible. Using the scripture for moral lessons, we have to ignore the context in which it has come. Now, with that background, let's now go on to the interpretation of the text. It says, sermon and on the interpretation of the text. Sermon preparation involves a great deal of Bible interpretation. The following steps are suggested to interpret the text for sermon. Thank you. Study and analyze the text meditatively in some modern translations and versions. Unless you have studied English and you are well above average in understanding English language, you may not be able to grasp KJV very well. For some of you who study classics and all of that, you are very familiar with KJV. But new KJV, revised standard version, and international versions are recommended versions. Don't forget that we did more with your courses in theological training, especially those who are newly coming to ministry from secondary school and from university. These are the versions that we recommend for them to study and analyze. Then develop an outline from your study of the text in line with the particular objective of the sermon. Don't forget the objective of the sermon as you try to develop an outline. Then there are many principles that help a person in proper interpretation of the Bible. The literal principle, which combines historical and grammatical elements, takes the natural, straightforward sense of the text or passage as fundamental. It's the basic principle. From all of this explanation, you will see that three tasks are very, very close together. Number one, hermeneutics or interpretation. Number two, preaching. And number three, theology. All of these tasks go along together. Preaching is a theological task because you are speaking for God. You are speaking the word of God. Preaching is an hermeneutical task because you are interpreting the word of God. I'm going to explain a little bit more when we come to the closing session tomorrow about how all of these relates together. But as you try to interpret the word of God, you have to be careful of literalism. There are a number of Bible passages that contain imagery and metaphor, some allegories, and such other figurative portions of the Bible. You need to be very, very conscious of it. But to a large extent, historical, grammatical, and literal principle implies that when you have prayed well and you have studied well, you can discover the truth of scriptures for yourself and also to preach and teach others. But there are a number of other principles that can help you to interpret the Bible. Christocentric principle. There are people who find Christ in virtually every page of scriptures, and that can be used to preach. Contextual principle. Bear in mind the context. Harmonization principle. Sometimes people think that one section of the Bible contradicts another section. That is not possible. God is not capable of self-contradiction. God cannot contradict himself. God cannot say something yesterday and say something today and contradict himself. When there seems to be contradictions in the Bible, take that to study very well and harmonize them, because God does not contradict himself. So there are two major steps which regard to biblical communication. Number one is exegesis, trying to find out the meaning. What it meant then, when it was first given, when it was first revealed. And then now, what it meant means now. What it means now is exposition. And that is the task of interpretation and application. So, two steps. Number one, exegesis. Number two, exposition. But exposition includes both interpretation, illustration, as well as application. More and more of this will be explained. Let's move on with interpretation of text. How do you interpret the text? Study the context of the passage that you have chosen. That's why when you want to preach, you take time to read, take time to meditate. Interpret the text within the context. That is a rule in biblical interpretation. You interpret the text bearing in mind the context. When we ignore the context to interpret and use the text, we have what we call a proof text. You must have heard about proof text. Proof text. What does it mean to proof text? You are proof testing when you interpret the text out of context. When you interpret the text, ignoring the context. A text which is out of context is a proof text, or it is also a pretext. So when you are studying the text very well, you have done a lot of analysis, you have taken many, many notes. Now, you can now consult study Bibles to enrich your presentation. I want to mention some recommended study Bibles. The NIV study Bible, devotional study Bible, like Application Bible and African Study Bible. There are many others that are very good, but you know, I can't mention all. So I have to mention the ones that I'm familiar with. So, good, apart from the Bible version itself, the Bible text itself, the first resource that I will encourage us to consult is a study Bible. Some other materials are very helpful for Bible interpretation and sermon preparation. You cannot go to Bible companies to look for some words, Bible dictionary to look at the meaning of words, theological dictionary. When there's a turning theological issue, like I said, there is something that is puzzling, something that looks like a contradiction. Look at that topic in the theological dictionary. Read it. It will give you some insight. The Bible commentaries. In training, we recommend Bible commentaries to be read last. Why? Bible commentaries are written from a particular theological perspective or even bias. That is not the bad thing. It's just that Bible commentary is the finished product of a thought system. If you have not read every commentary will look correct to you. And what you read with this one will be different from what this one says. And you will not be able to make sense out of the two. Because everyone will look good, everyone will look perfect. Because they are the products of exegesis, of interpretation, also of application. They should be read last. By the time you are reading commentaries, actually your sermon should have been prepared. And then by the time you are reading, it will amaze you that some of the insight that God has given you on your own, God has also given it to others. And where there are differences of opinion, it will not be difficult for you to resolve. But if you go to the commentary first, I can guarantee you, it will stop your hope for the exploration and study of the Word of God. The books are excellent to interpret the Word of God. I think the Bible comes first, the book comes second, and the minister's manual should come third. These are the three documents I want to see with every Baptist pastor. The minister's manual, confidence to the Bible, and the hymn book. Now, when you are preparing to preach a sermon, you continue to read and read. You read the text. The gospel ministry is an educated ministry. The preaching ministry is an educated ministry. That's why Pastor Gary allowed the pastor to go and study and take a PhD in the UK. We must be educated. Education is not opposed to spirituality. Education enhances it. If you see a man who's married by a preacher, whose preaching has been destroyed by education, it is because he had a racial spirituality. When you are spiritual, by the grace of God, and by getting it, enhances the presentation of the gospel and your preaching ministry. So read and read and read. As you read study text, you read the background of the text, the location of the text, the theme of the text, something about the text, you see, no, application and all of that will be formed in your mind. By the time that you are standing before the pulpit, you are coming out of the fire of revelation that God has given you. When you have finished the application of the test, you are ready now to develop the sound. You want to develop the sound. What do you mean by development of the sound? Most sermons have three major parts. How do you introduce body of the sermon and the conclusion of the sermon. Starting with the sermon title, what is going to be the title of the sermon? That will not be the first thing, but I'm sure for the conclusion. Sometimes we are not sure of what the title is going to be, but we have concluded. But you should have a working idea, the working title of the sermon. The title of the sermon should be well phrased and precisely stated. Other qualities of the title are clarity, accuracy, narrowness, and brevity. It's good to have very good sermon title. Sermon title should not sound like a sad topic. It should not sound academic. Habakkuk chapter 3, verse 18. You want to preach on that? Yes, I will rejoice. That's a good one. That says it. Instead of Christian conduct in the midst of adversity. Yeah, it's okay. That's also says it. But that sounds a little academic. should hear and rejoice. That is very biblical, that is very simple, that is very practical. You want to preach on Galatians chapter 2, verse 17 through 21, and titling the crucified life, based on verse 20, and be crucified with Christ. Instead of saying principles of spiritual and practical principles of mortification and consecration in Christianity. That's bombastic. Some people come up with some titles to impress people that they have studied. Make someone title easy for people to carry, easy to reflect, easy to think about. Very important. Now, your sermon title may be implicit or explicit. It is explicit when it says exactly what you want to preach about. You must be born again. That's like John 3, verses 1 to 8. That is very, very explicit. Sometimes you can be implicit. Once in a while, you may use a sermon title to hide the objective and try to catch people unaware, especially if you are the pastor of a church. I have once preached on idols on the battlefield to talk about desperate things that people do to cope with challenges of life. Philistines carry the idols on the battlefield when they face wars that are very, very critical. And I use that to teach people to talk about when people do desperate things. When the leader is sick, I have used that before to preach from the book of Hosea, spirituality without morality, worship without sacrifice. When religion is sick, your religion is sick. But that's an implicit type sermon title. And sometimes the sermon title can be in between. I've preached before on the extra mile, based on Matthew chapter 5, verse 41. Patience and forbearance, relationship with people. Introduction. How do you introduce a sermon? The introduction should awaken an interest in the theme and prepare the hearers for what is to follow. One or more methods can be considered to introduce a sermon, including introduce the text, explain the topic or title, state the specific objective, highlight the problem or situation, come up with a slight quotation, or just an illustration. These are different ways for you to introduce a sermon. From the viewpoint of theory, the introduction should be about 10% of the time you want to preach. If you are going to preach for 1 hour, then you can introduce, you can spend about 5 or 6 minutes to introduce. If you are going to preach for 30 minutes, you can spend about 3 minutes. I say that is very, very theoretical. But it helps. It helps. While we were in seminary and we were in preaching class, when it was my turn to preach, I preached from 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 to 7. I spoke about the hardship of soldier, the discipline of being an athlete, and the hard work of being a farmer. And I thought I gave a great sermon. But the preacher, the class teacher gave me a very poor mark. Because he said, I spent 15% of the time trying to introduce the sermon. I said, no, that's wrong. Now, if you spend 50% of the time trying to introduce the sermon, by the time you now want to talk about the substance and the main essence of the sermon, you have lots of people. Because not everybody has a long attention span. Your introduction should catch people, should be witty, should awaken the interest of people, and then you move on. If something is important, don't wait to the very end, unless it's a kind of sermon that I'm going to talk about very soon. Let's move on now to development of the sermon. It's going to be the last slide where I'm going to conclude. I've made some comments about the title. An introduction. Let me now make some comment about the body of the sermon. The body of the sermon. This is the real plan of the sermon. In homiletics, it is called the argument. This is the argument of the sermon, or it's the real plan of the sermon. The body of the sermon should be carefully organized, following a natural or logical order, considering a number of factors. Number one, the importance of the climax. If you are preaching on the story, you have to build a story to a climax. Like the story of Elijah and the prophet of Baal, you build up the story. Don't preach half, get into the climax, and then you come to the climax. That would not be good enough. The story is telling. Or you can move from general to specific. when you are trying to develop the body of the sample. Such as, but as for you, others believe like this. This may be the general trend, but this is what God is asking you to do. You are moving from general situation to a specific situation, or from cause to effect. This was the fall of man. These were the consequences that came upon man or human life. Or question and answer. You ask a question, you provide the answer. We find that in Romans and the book of Malachi, also in the Old Testament. Or even the very popular style, this is the problem and this is the solution. Just like the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus, our Lord. See, various approaches to develop the body of the Son. As you do, all the subtopics, major and minor points, illustration, references, you should apply very, very properly. When you are developing the body of the sermon, please don't forget the objective. If there are things that are not considered important and critical, and you don't have time, remove it from the body of the sermon. Let your sermon speak to the objective that God has given you to preach about. Generally, if you don't deal with many points, make your sermon strong, sharp, and pointed. Make it strong, make it sharp, and make it pointed. We tell pastors of churches, don't preach everything this week. If you preach everything this week, what are you going to preach next week? And please do not bore people. One reason preaching on sermon has lost respect in some places is because some of us preachers have bored people. Not all of us are equally gifted, like some of the preachers who preach well and can still get your attention in spite of the fact that they preach well. How do you conclude? Let's conclude. Include how to conclude in your sermon preparation. When you are planning the sermon, when you are planning to preach, how do you start? How do you develop it? How do you conclude? Reflect prayerfully. Now, the Holy Spirit may change that thought or give you a splash of inspiration to me. Still, all of that is okay. But you yourself, as part of your preparation, decide to plan how do you conclude. The purpose of the conclusion is to emphasize the purpose of the sermon and invite the hearers to respond appropriately. The conclusion should be personal, specific, positive, and vigorous. There are many ways to conclude a sermon. It may conclude with an illustration, a poem or story, or you may recapitulate or summarize, or you may make a direct appeal. But decide how you are going to conclude the sermon. So you will not be like an aircraft and a pilot that takes off very well and moves very well, but does not know how to land. It's important to take off well. It's important to maintain stability in the air, but it's also important to land well and to conclude well. These are some important some ideas about the process of sermon preparation. Tomorrow, by the grace of God, I'm going to conclude on the real art of preaching. I'll spend every minute that I wanted to. So I'm sorry I'm not able to give the time. I don't know I'm going to give. But we can spend a few minutes to make some comments before we go on break.